Daniel Percasia, who will speak on reaction mechanisms on liquid and solid acids.
Thank you very much. When you called me and asked me about whether I would like to speak in the symposium on analytic soil, I said I would be mostly honored to participate in such an event. Actually, I had grown accustomed to be with kids holding meetings that if we could heckle each other's talk. Kids, I've missed you badly over the past year. I hope I see more of you. You heard already the title of my talk, and I want to point out to the sponsor of it, and to show very quickly the person that deserves the credit, my younger colleagues that did the work, and my less young colleagues that collaborated with us for advised us. And in the talk on acidity and its influence, I have put a slide which I usually put in such situations, pointing out to the vast range of acidities that we have to take into account whenever we try to assess the effect of strength on the reaction or its mechanism. I would, for today's purpose, only try to emphasize that just as in the evaluation of acidity, one has to match properly the strength of the acid of interest with the strength of the base that we used to measure. It's exactly the same with the substrates. We can be badly misled if we take a substrate of high basicity on a strongly acid catalyst. Likewise, if we consider that pyridine is fully protonated in 2 molar hydrochloric acid, we can see immediately that if we dissolve pyridine or if we put pyridine on any type of acid which is much stronger, most of what we see will not be related to the pyridine protonation. So everything which we can see about pyridine protonation, whether by thermal effect or whatever else, is already fully measured here. What we see extra might be relevant, for instance, might be the degree of stabilization of the anion which is formed, but it might as well not be. Therefore, it is very important to think and to analyze the experiments in advance and the results afterwards very carefully in all these type of studies. The next point is that the way in which we express and we consider our results is also very important, and pitfalls abound. Namely, everybody has seen and used these quantities. We should point out that an acidity function has meaning only if in the measurement a certain activity coefficient cancels, which in many cases does not, and one precise set of conditions which it does not is when acid and base upon protonation form a tight ion pair. And most classical case in which a tight ion pair is formed is on a solid. So we have to keep in mind that the chemistry of tight ion pairs is not the same as the ideal type of chemistry which one considers normally, and that unfortunately most of carbocationic chemistry applied to real life catalysts has disregarded this point. When one thinks of a probe base, of course one should find one which works for the purpose, and I'll show you an example in the next couple of slides. 2 years ago in Baltimore, there was, after the Congress, sort of a group of sessions entitled Discussions on Acid Catalysis. And for half a day, the people there have debated whether water is protonated in some zeolite or another. And the discussion got rather heated. And we thought, well, that would be interesting to see how the matter stands by running oxygen 17 NMR on water in acid, by calibrating. We know that in such a situation, one determines easily the degree of protonation by interpolation between the chemical shift for the protonated base and for the non-protonated base. And we knew that on solids we have the problems of inability of removing the second order dipolar interactions even by magic anti-spinning, but we knew that one can do double rotation. We did not have the conditions, but we thought that if we demonstrate that this works, maybe other people that have the conditions can use the technique, and maybe some of them might even cite us. But we were flabbergasted by the result, namely that upon going to 100% water to 100% hydronium ions, we get curved with a maximum, a well-defined maximum. We and a number of people that we asked were unable to come up with an intuitive explanation for this phenomenon. But I must say that the ab initio calculation of chemical shifts does predict this behavior, but that's a counterintuitive sort of approach, so we have to leave it at that. Another point, however, about water is that it is the most peculiar base from another viewpoint, and that refers to its basic strength. Since it's tricky to measure the basic strength of water, we measure the acid strength of hydronium ion. And I'll go only to the conclusion. We found that it varies enormously with the nature of the counter ion, which boils down to the fact that we have an ion pair, and the acidity of hydronium ion is enormously variable depending upon the nature of the counter ion in the ion pair, which can be, I think, safe enough assigned to the very large change in the activity coefficient of water. Ion pairing has an effect not only on the catalyst, but also on the substrate. And putting it in an ion pair, we see that the geometry, the structure of the carbocation changes entirely. And that has an effect on the properties, and the next example will show this quickly. This is the Nexomol, the tertiary butyl cation, and these calculations were conducted to mimic the crystal, because there was something which we didn't like about the description and theoretical interpretation of the infrared spectrum of the tertiary butyl cation. Namely, the stable form of that ion in the gas phase was completely different from this. It's a propeller shape of molecule, but when trying to interpret the infrared spectrum of that species, the authors used a structure which had been calculated to be a transition state. And they argued that, well, the energy surface must be flat. But if it was flat, definitely, at least in the predominant manner, the form that was the energy minimum should have contributed, not only the form that was a transition state. But the explanation is quite simple. Upon putting and allowing the carbocation to float freely, actually all these triple ion floats freely into the in this space. So we have what we call a double-decker sandwich of cation, anion, cation, anion, cation. The organic species indeed rearranges in a geometry, in a structure, which makes perfect sense in terms of the infrared spectrum. So we can see that ion pairing changes chemistry entirely. Another important feature of solid acids, in addition to tight ion pair formation, is rigidity, which means that the acid sides cannot do what is essential in solution, namely to help each other. What we call the cooperative effect in proton transfer cannot be manifested on solid acids. And the immediate consequence is that solid acids are weak, are much weaker than predicted based on structure and models in solution. And that's a fact, and we've seen it, and I'll show just one example, and this will be important because this is Nephion 117 has been, should I say, to saturation, presented in literature as a model of catalysis on a solid superacid. It is not. We can see that using a proper measurement, we cannot use acidity functions, obviously. We can compare it reasonably with something like between 8 and 85% sulfuric acid, which is 6 orders of magnitude weaker than the predicted strength based on the liquid with similar structure. An interesting example of a consequence of the peculiar nature of solids is in this subject of penta-coordinated carbon intermediates. Now, I won't go over the history of it and the debate which existed, which took place a time between Olar and Hoogeveen, but I'll only point out this discussion of the dual mechanism on some solid acids. Monomolecular and bimolecular, in some conditions we have this type of mechanism in which the hydride transfer was important. In the other, just a proton transfer, the formation of a penta-coordinated cationic intermediate. But I'd like to point out that everything is fine, but we are not talking about two different mechanisms. We are talking about two steps of the same mechanism. This is the initiation step, and this is the propagation step. So when we compare, we must have conditions in which one is faster, the other is slower, one is controlling the process or not, but we are not talking about two mechanisms. So everything which we do in interpreting, if these things have relevance, and all we have to keep in mind that these are steps of the same mechanism. So this is the initiation, and this is the propagation. Initiation sometimes might be completely different, and the propagation can be the same. So it is very important to keep in mind all the special features of different types of acid. We've looked, trying to figure out, we went generally in the opposite direction like most people. We started the problem in the end with a theoretical representation, and we looked for examples to see how it works. And as examples of solids that might be of interest, some years ago we looked first at sulfated metal oxide, sulfated zirconia, and what we saw very interesting was that when we used a substrate that could not, a saturated substrate that could not eliminate, that could not form an olefin in any way, mechanistically was prevented, or structurally it was prevented, we got oxygen containing, we got material that had carbon-oxygen bond. And we got the same type of oxygenase when we put aromatics, benzene, for instance, for phenol at 80 degrees. So this is a clear. And another very important thing, we got products which were unmistakably and undoubtedly coming from coupling of free radicals. So we developed a mechanism based on these results. Obviously, when the species that gets oxidized on the surface can eliminate, it will eliminate and form that tiny amount of olefin, which will be able to initiate a cationic or cationoidic, depending upon the degree of freedom of ions on the site, which is possible at the acidity level of the catalyst. When we use something which could not eliminate, we saw what was before, which we called the surface ester species. Now, we can predict certain consequences as, for instance, this material should have higher activity than predicted based on acid strength. They should deactivate very easily. And chosen proper substrate, they should show the telltale species of free radical intermediates, namely dimers, in significant quantities. And here is a comparison of sulfated zirconia with aluminum chloride for isomerization of methylcyclopentane. Now, we can see that sulfated zirconia is much more active at the beginning than aluminum chloride. Aluminum chloride is a good example because actually it's a liquid phase catalyst. The carbocationic reaction takes place if you have solid aluminum chloride in a film on the surface of the catalyst, or in what people call the sludge. On the other hand, we can see that reaction on sulfated zirconia never reaches equilibrium. The catalyst dies before, whereas aluminum chloride goes to the equilibrium. And we can see the formation of dimers. Now, unlike, for instance, C8, where if you put, and people have tried, and they inject a small amount of iso-octane in isomerization of butane, isobutane in whatever, and the C8 vanished immediately, instantly, and gave small molecules, the peculiarity of this cyclic C6 is that immediately after dimerization goes to dimethyl decalates, which are very stable, so any cracking would require breaking of at least three bonds. Therefore, we can see the dimers, and we can see there is no dimer with aluminum chloride, and there is a burst of dimers just at the beginning of the reaction with sulfated zirconia, which then continues at slower pace. And another thing which we predicted is that the catalyst needs time to start doing anything. And since we had developed a method of controlling the activity of the catalyst, preparing sulfated zirconia with higher or lower acidity as we wanted, we saw that there is an induction period, and that induction period is perfectly tied to the activity of the catalyst. The less active catalyst had a longer induction period, and lowering the temperature again, the induction period gets longer. Now, what other solid acid would be to look at? Well, zeolites. Everybody is working or had been working with zeolites, but we needed a reaction which we can use under conditions not too much different. The problem is that it wouldn't be mechanistically relevant to compare something at room temperature with something at 300 degrees. So we looked and found that in the of all possible reactions, the interconversion of methyl pentanes is the one which works the easiest. So we chose a pair of catalysts. One was trifluoromethane sulfonic acid, is a weak super acid, 100 times stronger than sulfuric acid, and it's not as oxidizing as sulfuric acid. It still has oxidizing abilities, and it has been demonstrated that one can promote the reaction in trifluoromethane sulfonic acid by one electron oxidation, but it's not as oxidizing. So we studied methyl pentane interconversion on trifluoric acid and on the zeolite. Now, again, this is in the first case, a liquid-liquid heterogeneous reaction. It takes place on the surface, so we try not to disturb the surface too much so that it's constant and we can measure rates. But when we left it undisturbed, the problem was that immediately under the interface we saw a yellow color getting. That was a very nice graduation of colors. And so to remove that, we just homogenized occasionally every 15 minutes, we homogenized the acid layer. Now, the course of reaction is completely different in the two modes, in the controlled mode and in the uncontrolled or in the non-homogenized mode. When we homogenized the acid layer, we saw a reasonably behaved reaction. When we did not homogenize it, as the top of the lower layer got darkly colored, suddenly the reaction at first didn't go, and suddenly it jumped fast, and at the same time we saw a sizable amount of cracking product. Whereas in the homogenized mode of reaction, the cracking products never went over 1%. They hovered somewhere here at the bottom within the limits of error of our measurement, which indicates that actually it's not that simply cracking follows isomerization and they go on the same pathway, but it looks like cracking is promoted by species, organic materials of high basicity. We tried to look at this mechanistically and we determined the activation parameters, which of course can be compared with Brouwer's. This was diffusion control. And why I'm pointing this out is that people have imported Brouwer's data in terms of identifying the rate-determining states without reading and seeing that he used quite special reaction conditions, so those results are not translatable into other catalytic systems. And we can see that it cannot be the actual isomerization of the carbocation. Obviously, the hydride transfer step is out of question. So the only possibility is that what we have here, we are measuring the ionization step. Okay, so up, what the most likely course of event is an initial formation of some intermediate which is like an ester, and then ionization on the same kind of solvolysis of alkyl sulfonates, and that's what we measure. We tried to look at reacting intermediates. We couldn't see any, but we did see the nature of poisons. This is a typical spectrum for an allyl catalytic mixture, cyclopentene and cyclohexene, which form when the catalyst is left for a long time. Now, to compare the zeolite with this, we took CSM5 and we did at the lowest temperature we could work at, about 120 degrees. And what you see, in under the same conditions, liquid on solid. And again, we saw induction period. People have seen induction periods on zeolites, but this was taken as a fact of nature, and people have just looked at what happens after the catalyst stabilizes. Now, after this induction period, we see isomerization, but we see normal hexane. What's normal hexane doing here? It shouldn't be there, but it is. And here's an example. Several temperatures, putting at the same temperature triflic acid and HCSM5, we see that for HCSM5 we have 4 to 1 2 metal planes contain all hexene. It should be 10 to the 4th. So hexane cannot be formed by isomerization. Whether it's formed by coupling or cracking or free radicals. Here we can see actually that the cracking products are seen at the first sampling, whereas hexane only afterwards. So it might be the same species that form cracking form also hexane. When we repeated this in the gas phase, we saw something different. Now, were we to take the first sample here, we would see what most people saw, that cracking follows isomerization. As a matter of fact, isomerization follows cracking. Again, there are two different pathways. Why do we do not see any normal hexane here? And might be some matter of reactivity. Everyone saw this type of behavior, namely on HSM5 hexane and 3-methyl pentane. This is much more reactive. Yes, but that was in the gas phase. When we took the solution, the liquid phase, the relative reactivity is completely different. Does the reaction occur on the surface? Does the mechanism is the mechanism completely different? We don't have time to debate now. I have just 1 minute before I'll be thrown out of here. So I'll show you only what we try to do in an attempt at identifying reactive intermediates. We didn't see anything easily, but a catalyst left for a longer time could be showed something interesting in the carbon NMR. Now, this is not a dead catalyst, but it's a catalyst with decreased activity. It has stayed for 65 hours at 120 feet. And you shouldn't think that we had there high concentration of organic species, that there is a very large number of scans behind these spectrum. So we have to acquire a lot of data in order to do this spectrum. And these are some aliphatic carbons. And there are three points of interest. This is a carbon-oxygen bond, so we got an alkoxy intermediate. Now, people have seen what they call silanol ester, or what we call surface ester. But in all previous cases, those are from either from alcohols or from olefins, species of high reactivity and high basicity. We obtain these species from the alkene in the isomerization of 3-methyl pentane with all these species. Now, no alkenyl cation peaks are observed. Instead, we obtain aromatics. So it is possible that cyclopentane and cyclohexanyl species interconvert. We know that. We've studied ourselves that composition years ago. And then aromatized. And most interesting, well, this is so small that I shouldn't venture, but I would still likely put on the record as having stated this here. The position is fitting for a phenolic carbon. So that, I think, will show enough that to make us all think that the liquid acid and solid acids are not necessarily two different strands of the same type of behavior, but they might act differently mechanistically, and they have, as a consequence, be different by nature. Thank you very much.
Well, so we can keep on schedule, sir, we should go to the next presentation.